Very good morning to all. We are in the mode of the continuation of the yesterday lecture. Whatever we have studied yesterday by our honorable guest, yesterday we have introduced the Simulia brand and there some applications. Today we are going to be learned some little more about the finite element simulation and the abacus. So we have here again Mr. Prakash sir. Prakash sir, very good morning.
And very good morning, sir.
Cordially welcome from the entire Parul University, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And very good morning to all the joinees today. I hope you can see my screen. Please confirm if you are able to see my screen.
Yes, sir. Sorry to interrupt you. I would like to say something. Mm-hmm. Dear participants, what happened yesterday? You have already filled the feedback form. Today again, we are going to be share the same feedback form of the today itself. So you, what you have to do before that, you have to also mention your name along with your university and the mail ID. I repeat, name, university, and the mail ID in the chat box. So that if you are not there, we are going to be also give a provision to give you, provide you the certificate for the same. Second thing is that, please, yesterday, because of some reason, I don't know, one ma'am is there who started the presentation. I request you all, please make this habit to be avoided at any cost. The third thing, what I want to be share with you people, that in the middle of the session, anywhere we are going to be paste the feedback link in the chat box, which is going to be active only for the 1 hour. I repeat, we are going to paste the chat, the link in the chat box is going to be active for the 1 hour. So please be there, be attentive, and please take advantage of this session. Okay, hand over to the sir. Sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Yeah, please confirm if you're able to see my screen.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
We can
see. Fine. Yeah. Then we'll roll out. Okay, yesterday we briefly discussed about what Simulia is all about, some of the applications like Abacus, Tosca, EyeSight, and FESafe, which you know, falls under finite element applications under Simulia brand. So let's understand something about finite element analysis and let's have some demo on it to give you a taste of Abacus today. Just some, you know, a few basic knowledge on this. Let's begin with what is finite element analysis. Okay, finite element analysis, if you go to any, you know, Wikipedia, or if you open any book, finite element analysis is a numerical method used to solve engineering problems. This is what you learn with an array of mathematical techniques subdivided, you know, you discretize a large problem or a large CAD model into discrete elements called finite elements. Then you solve the problem or solve the, you know, the equations for these elements and reassemble it. This is what you learn in you know, in your books. But isn't it pretty confusing for, you know, graduate students? Maybe I feel when I was in you know, graduation, this was like you know, some alien language for me, you know. So I thought I'll learn in a simpler way rather than a complicated equation man. So I started framing the same for my own understanding. Let's break it simple. Okay, you have a tree outside and you're next to that standing. Okay, now you in a tree, if you look at a tree, you have different components, like you have branches, you have a trunk, you have leaves, you have flowers, you have fruits, a lot of components, you have roots, etc. So all these different components respond differently to the environment and also to you. Okay, so if you go up and pull a branch, it will bend, or if you, you know, if you take a leaf, it will crumble. Okay, but try hitting the trunk of the tree. You know what happens? You're going to break your leg. Okay, and why is that? Because Okay, sorry. Because the geometry, the material, the materials, and you know, between different components of the chair different. The materials are different between the two, and the shape of the components are different, and how they respond is also different. So the trunk of the tree is made of hardwood, while the leaf is made of much softer material. So breaking down into basics, if you break down into basic components, you have the geometry of the trees and the general shape, and you have the materials. So within a fever, these two things are really important, the geometry and the material. Geometry can be from a cat, and material is, you can imagine something like that fills the geometry, okay? It can be a steel, it can be rubber, it can be some other wood material, or it can be some other composite material, it can be anything. So it is a fill. Now, when we say finite element analysis, why we are saying it as a finite element? Why not an infinite element? Okay. Now you have a geometry. Okay, it has infinite properties. Infinite, you know, we call it as infinite geometry. Okay. Now what we are going to do is we are going to break these, discretize this geometry, CAD geometry, into finite number of elements. That is why we call it finite element methods or finite element analysis. The geometry is broken into finite mesh with what we call as elements. And these elements can be one dimensional, two dimensional, or three dimensional. Okay. Now we are saying we can break the, you know, geometry into different element types like 1D or 2D or 3D, whatever. But where do you exactly apply these? They have their own specific applications. Okay. For example, if you're modeling a whole life structure, or what you can see on the slide over here, there you can use 1D elements or beam elements or truss elements, for example. Okay, so if you're creating a you know, truss like structure like a bridge, you might be learning in your mechanics of solids or any engineering mechanics subjects, you might be solving problems based on your truss problems or you know, sheet metal problems. In such cases, you can use for truss problems, you can use 1D elements. Now when you have sheet metal like components or plastic components like the body in white for automotive components, automotive, okay, there you can use 2D elements. What you can see here, these are the 2D elements. So these 2D elements can be again have different types. Okay, again, all the dimensional elements you see have different types, like beam and truss for 1D, and if you go to in 2D, there are three noded triangular elements or four noded quadrilateral elements. And each element, whatever the element you divide, your the geometry will have a corresponding set of nodes. Okay, like this, 1, 2, 3, what you see here are the nodes. Okay, or a six noded or eight noded, depending on the application, you're going to choose what type of element you want to use for this particular problem. For 3D, again, okay, for like bulkier components or solid components like this, engine block, this is an engine block. For such components, we are going to use 3D elements, like 3D tetrahedral elements or hexa elements, like four noded tetrahedral or six noded or eight noded here, hexagon elements, hexa elements, or what we call as hexa sometimes, or 10 noded where you have a mid node in between, or a 20 noded hexa elements. So within these dimensional elements, what we have learned so far is they have their own different types, and you can have block elements, quad elements, beam elements, okay, that can be used in their own specific application. Okay, so for example, you can use beam to represent poles or cables, 2D tria or quad elements to represent sheet or sheets or any thin components. Okay, when I say thin components, the thickness of the component is much lesser than the length of the component. Okay, like you can imagine maybe a plastic infinite metal sheet, what do you see for rolling and all? Now, once we discretize with the elements, next important thing is the loads and boundary conditions. What you see here is a car crash. Okay. Now you need to tell the solver, okay, so this is my boundary conditions. Okay, this is a boundary. The wall is a boundary. So the car will hit the boundary at a particular speed. My speed is or the velocity will be the load for the analysis. Okay. So once you discretize and once you tell the solver, okay, this is my geometry, this is the discretized model. Okay, and the model possesses so and so properties, like 2D properties or 3D properties, and this is the material I'm going to fill with the I'm going to assign to the these elements or fill the geometry with. Then you set up your loads and boundary conditions, where you tell the solver, okay, this is the constraint or this is the boundary condition. Okay, the wall, for example, in this case, or maybe if you look at the seat belt here, it comes with it crashes with the velocity. Okay, now you're providing some loads and boundary conditions. This is the next step. This is how you start progressing from your CAD geometry to finite element geometry. Next is what solver you need to use. Now, yesterday we discussed we have different solvers, like implicit solver and explicit solver. Now the question is, okay, now I have modeled everything, I have my geometry, I've discretized my geometry into finite elements, I've provided a 2D elements, 2D property with a thickness of 2 mm, and I have assigned a material to this. But what solver should I use? That's the next question. Type of solver depends on the type of application where you're going to use it. For example, if you're interested in using for a high speed dynamic event, like a crash event or a drop test, okay, like you're dropping your phone on the floor, okay, the event time is like in milliseconds. So for high speed dynamic analysis, we use explicit solver, and implicit solver for static or quasi static simulations, linear dynamics. Okay, for such cases we use implicit solver in Abacus. So Abacus has Abacus standard and Abacus explicit. So Abacus standard is used for implicit applications and the linear dynamic applications. Okay, and whereas explicit solver is used for explicit simulations like high speed dynamic and non-linear dynamic simulations. Okay. So now let's see a small couple of demos on how we are going to use Abacus for this. For these demos, let's start with a small demo. Okay, just give me a minute. I'm pausing my presentation to open the Abacus application. Okay, I hope you can see my screen now back again. Okay, when you start Abacus, you'll be asked on what type of solver you want to, or what type of model database you want to create. So since we are interested in structural simulation, we're going to select Abacus standard or explicit. And this is the Abacus CAE. Which is a preprocessor, okay. Okay, so this is Abacus CAE, which is a preprocessor. So when I say preprocessor, it means you need to create a geometry, okay, or import a geometry from a CAD tool, and you need to clean up the geometries if at all needed. Okay, when you import a geometry, it might have some data loss, maybe some surfaces are missing, some lines are missing. You need to adjust those before you mesh. Okay, so discretization is called meshing. Okay, we divide the CAD into discrete elements, finite elements, and that process is called meshing. Before meshing, we need to clean up the geometry and do some tweaks if at all required. So this process is called pre-processing. So we have pre-processing where we import the geometry or create a geometry, then assign the properties and create elements on it. Next is the solver. So next we'll once we create all the loads and boundary conditions, then we are going to take this to the solver. Okay, we are going to tell the solver, okay solver, this is my geometry, these are the elements, okay, which covers my geometry or which captures my geometry, and these are the conditions, this is my load working conditions, okay, this is my beam element or a beam, a cantilever beam, and which is fixed at one end, which is my boundary condition, and I have a load at another end, which is my load or a force at one end, which is my load. So solver will understand this, okay, this is the beam element, these are the beam structure, and this is the structure, and these are the loads and boundary conditions, and it will start solving the equations for that particular problem. So Abaqus CAE incorporates the analysis modules into a complete Abaqus environment for modeling, managing, and monitoring Abaqus analysis and visualizing results. So each module contains a logical subset of overall functionalities. Can you see my screen? Hello? Maybe I'm lost.
No, sir.
Because I got a notification here. Okay. Let me re-present again. Please confirm if you are able to see my screen.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. So, it has a more logical way of arranging the modules. We call everything as module, the part module, the property module, or the assembly module, step module, etc. Okay, so the model tree is on the left, which will capture all your sequence of operations here. Like if you go to part module, whatever you have done, it will be captured. Another part module, if you're doing something in a step module, I'll come to what step module is and what assembly module is. Okay. It will capture everything in the model tree, and you can review it, you can hide it, you can delete it whenever you need certain operations. And whatever the operations you see here are also available from the menu over here. Okay, the part module is for creating a part, or okay, let's say you have a huge assembly, and any assembly will start from a part. Okay, so we are going to use part module to create geometries or import the geometries which is already available in the CAD from a different CAD, CAD applications like CATIA or SolidWorks or etc. etc. We are going to import it, okay, using file import part. We're going to import that part. Then we are going to do some cleanup if at all required in this module. Okay. Next is a property module. In this module, once we have created a part, let's say I have created a 3D block. Okay, now the solver will not understand what exactly it is. So I'm going to tell the solver using the property module. Okay, solver, this is a 30 by 30 by 30 block, which is a solid. Okay, I'm going to provide the section properties. Like I'm telling the solver, this is a solid part. And I'm going to assign some material. I'm going to tell the solver, okay, this is my material, steel, for example. And these are the properties which part will have, like Young's modulus and Poisson's ratio, etc. We hope you can see this. Yeah. So I'm going to tell the information like this. Next is the assembly. Now we have different parts. I'm going to bring all the parts in the assembly module and I'll assemble them. Okay. I'll arrange them in a logical sense, in a more logical sense. Next is a step module. This is where I'm going to tell the solver, okay, this is my block or this is my assembly. I'm going to run a frequency analysis, for example, a modal analysis, for example, or a linear static analysis or a transient analysis, okay, through step module. I'm going to create a, for example, I can, I'm going to tell the solver, okay, this is my model and I need to run an explicit analysis. I'll tell the solver, okay, like this, I'm going to select dynamic explicit and this will ask me for how long I need to run the simulation for the event. Okay, the crash simulation will not last for like maybe a second or 1 millisecond or so. I'm going to tell the solver like this. Okay, this is a way of communicating to the solver. Next is the interactions. Interactions, since you have assembly, okay, and you need to, in assembly, sometimes the parts may come in contact with each other. So this is where I'll tell the solver, okay, these are my parts which may come in contact during the analysis, during the simulation. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell the solver, these are the two parts, X and Y parts, this may come in contact or these are already in contact, this may engage and disengage during the process, okay. So I'm going to tell the solver through interaction module by creating contacts. Next is loads and boundary conditions, which we already discussed. We are going to tell the solver these are my boundary conditions. This is like a cantilever beam, which we discussed, which is fixed at one end. And we are going to apply some force on it, which is on the other end. So the solver will understand what the boundary conditions are and what the loads are. Next, we are going to discretize it. Now, once we have everything arranged, then we're going to discretize the CAD model or the CAD geometry or infinite model into smaller finite elements using the mesh model. Once we are done, we are going to take this to the solver using the job module. So we are going to create a job. This is the job manager. This is where you manage all your runs, etc. We are going to tell the solver, so this is my model name, so-and-so, and I'm using 6 CPUs or 8 CPUs, for example. So the number of CPUs will speed up your simulation, okay? And this will take to the solver. After that, we have visualization, or this is where we post-process. Now, once we have a pre-processed model, we submit it to the solver. Okay, we have taken the problem to the solver and solver did all the simulation. Our solver did all the calculations and it has given us a result. Okay, I've calculated your beam problem now. Okay, now take the results. It will create a result file for us. We'll take this result file into the Abacus viewer or visualization module. Okay, then we are going to see what are the displacements for a particular given load or a force. Or we are going to see the stress, for example, whatever we are interested in. Okay. I hope you understand the different modules which I explained. Let's start with creating a sample problem, or we'll create a set of problems, not just one, but we'll try to get a taste of different types of simulations. Maybe a 3 or 4 simulations, maybe one optimization as well. Okay. Okay, we are going to start with a simple plate probe. My plate will be a 2D plate, okay, which is a thin sheet. So in the part module, I'm going to create a plate. Okay, this is a thin sheet. I hope you can see this. Okay, now I've created this. Now I'm going to tell the solver, okay, I've created a plate, or this is my geometry. Now I need to tell the solver what is the thickness of it. I didn't mention any thickness here in the part module, so I'm going to tell the solver this is a shell component, okay, with a thickness of 2 mm. Okay. Now this will ask you for what type of material you are going to use for your part. So we'll create a material for it. We'll name it as T. Plastic. We're going to give some Young's modulus and some Poisson ratio. Click OK. Now we have created this. Now we are going to attach or assign these to the plate what we have created. Okay. Now you see the color has changed from gray to a green color, which means this possesses some property. Okay. Like what we have talked about, a tree which possesses a geometry, which possesses some material. Now this, imagine this as a tree, the tree trunk which we have discussed. Okay, now this is a plate which possesses a material called steel, and it has a physical property of 2 mm thickness and some other dimensions. Okay. Next, we are going to assemble. Since we only have one single part, okay, we are not going to go in details, but we'll discuss about this later. Now, next is what type of simulation I'm going to use this. I'm saying I'm going to use a static simulation for this. Static simulation is where you geometry and your linear static is nothing but this is where your loads and material is linear. Okay, and you are applying at one single instances. So this is what we call static, and dynamic is where like transient dynamic, where your load may change with respect to time or frequency. Okay, that is a different discussion again. Okay. I'm saying I'm dividing the load into increments. Okay, 10% for every each increment. Since we only have one single path over here, we're not going into the interaction module. Next, we are going to create the loads and boundary condition. This is where we are going to tell the solver where I'm going to fix it and where I'm going to apply the loads. Okay, so I'm saying force. Continue. Okay, I'm going to apply some load here and here on these two nodes. This will ask me how much load I need to apply. I'm going to apply in X direction. You can see here. You can see the three quadrants here, X, Y, Z, and you also see a compass over here. Okay, this will come in handy. I'm going to use 10 newtons of load. Okay. You can see the representation of the force here.
चलो ठीक है. और मैं क्या बोल रहा था, सर्टिफिकेट सबको दे रहे हैं हम लोग इस बार, है ना? कल मिल जाएगा ना. फीडबैक कल भरे थे.
आई एम हियरिंग सम नॉइस, कैन यू प्लीज म्यूट? या थैंक यू. ओके, नाउ वी हैव अप्लाइड सम फोर्स हियर. सो वी आर गोइंग टू टेल द सॉल्वर, ओके दिस इज माय लोड, ओके ऑन दीस टू नोड्स. नेक्स्ट वी आर गोइंग टू क्रिएट सम बाउंड्री कंडीशंस. ओके, नाउ इमेजिन यू हैव अ प्लेट and you are trying to pull the plate from one end. Now if you are not fixed at the other end, it will keep on pulling. Imagine you are pulling a cart which is not fixed, so it will come along with you, like, right, similar to that. So we are going to fix this, the other edge over here. Okay, I'm fixing in all directions, so you can see it is fixed. Now you can see a representation of boundary conditions over here, right? Then once we are done, we are going into the mesh module. This is where we discretize. So as I've said, each element has a set of nodes associated with it. Now we are going to tell how many nodes, what is the size of okay, now we have discretized it with so and so element size. Okay, you can see it here, right? second. So here you can see the approximate global size is 5. So my approximate, the average size of my element is 5. Okay. Now then, once we have measured it, that means we have discretized it, and next is to run the simulation. What we are going to do is we are going to job module. We're going to give a name to it, late, for example. Okay. And I'm going to use more number of CPUs. It's like you're using more number of brains. Okay. So this will help me to speed up my simulation. Once you submit it, it will start. It will communicate with the solver, and it will, the solver will calculate the equations. It will do the math in the background and will give us the result at the end of the simulation. I can see it is running. Okay. The simulation is completed. You can see it in the status. Then we'll go to the visualization module. Now you can see how it is deformed. For since we applied the load only on the two nodes of this plate, okay, the only the nodes are pulled. Okay. So this is how you model in the Abacus CAE or Abacus GUI. Okay, this is a simple problem what we have just created. Now let's do a simple another analysis. Okay, on the same plate problem. Now what we'll do is we'll do some frequency calculations. We'll remove the force over here. We'll do a simple frequency analysis. What I'm going to do is I'm going to the step module. I'm just simply changing it. I'm going to replace it with frequency. Okay. This will ask me for what is the minimum frequency of interest. I'll say 1. I'll provide how many frequencies do I need. Number of eigen frequencies requested, I'll say 10, for example. So I'm going to ask the solver to give me the 10 frequencies, available frequencies, starting from 1. And then I don't have to do anything now. I'll just go to my job manager again. Then I can resubmit again, but I'll not do that. I'll do a frequency, rename it. Okay. I'll submit it again. So what I've done is I've for the same problem without doing anything. Okay. I've just changed the step or the type of analysis. I didn't do anything. Okay. So there is a beauty of finite element simulations. So if you're doing this in a real problem, you might have to do a lot of iterations. But here I have one second. There are some warnings over here. Maybe I've done some mistake. Okay, since oops. Okay, since it is a dynamic problem, we need to specify some mass. Okay, for that we need a density. What we'll do is we'll go to the material module and we'll provide a density to this. Okay. Submit. Okay, so what I've done is I've just with the existing problem, I've just changed the type of simulation, and I'm running it without doing any huge modifications. Now, if you have to do the same in a real problem, then you need to do a lot of iterations. Maybe you need to change a lot of things here and there to change the simulation type from one simulation type to the other simulation type, which might take a lot of time, lot of money, lot of manpower. You can see the problem is running now and it is completed. We're going into the visualization mode. So we have the frequencies over here. Now you can see. We have requested for 10 frequencies starting from 1, and we have 10 frequencies. The first frequency is 851, and the last frequency is 17430 for this particular problem. Okay. This is a different type of analysis what we have done without making any huge changes in the model. Similarly, you can create 1D elements, like if you're dealing with truss kind of problems, you can create 1D elements, okay? Excuse me. And you can start modeling your problems and solving the same in Abacus. Excuse me. The steps are not clear. So there's a question from Soumya Trivedi is asking, the steps are not clear. Can you let me know where you lost, or from where do you want me to explain?
Sir, the steps, when you applied the load, the command prompt is not visible. I cannot see where you applied the load.
Where I've applied the load. Okay. Okay, we'll take another problem and we'll discuss on the load. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Right. So what we'll do is we'll take another problem and with more, it's a little complex, not a complex problem. We'll have some contacts in this problem. Okay. Right. We'll start with a like maybe a block. Okay. Which is a solid. I'm going to create a block with some dimensions in my part module. My length will be around 600 and the breadth can be around 200. Now, since it is a solid model, this will ask us for the depth, okay, the thickness. We're going to use a default thickness of 20 mm. Now this is my block. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to trim this at a couple of places for better modeling. Okay. I'm creating some trim lines, so this will help me to. Okay, I've trimmed the block at these two ends. Now, why I've done this, we'll look at in the later stage. Now you might have heard about 3-point bending analysis, right? So we're going to create a 3-point bending with two supports and a one blank or one block, something like this, and a load carrying block, another load carrying block. Now we'll say load block, and we'll create a rigid component for this because we are not interested in the deformation of the block. Okay, let's make it the radius is around 15, which means we'll say 200 because our depth is around so the breadth is around 200 for the block. So we're going to create something like this. We'll create another which is support. Again, it is a discrete rigid component. Okay. I'm going to give up dimensions to it and a depth to it. I'm going to give a reference point because since it is a rigid, we need to provide some details to it. Now we are not going into details of what reference points and why they are used, but for time being, we're doing this. Okay. Then next, we are going to into a property module. Since our load block and support model CAD models or the geometries are rigid, we don't need any material for that. because we are telling the solver these are my rigid components, and when we talk about rigid components doesn't deform. Okay, so we are not interested in that. Now we are going to apply some material to this for the block. Going to use the same steel properties.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Hello, sir. Sir, actually, the thing is, whatever the subcommand window opens, that is, you are entering the material or load condition, that is not visible.
That is not visible. Now, you can see the window over here, the edit section window?
No, sir. We can only see the abacus, that main model window, that is your slab is there. That's it.
Okay, let me reshare. I'll stop the sharing and I'll reshare.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, can you confirm if you're able to see now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, now you are able to see the edit section window and everything, right?
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. Okay. 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 So what I've done is I've created some material property. Okay. Given some material details over here for steel. Next, I'm providing some physical property to let the solver know that this is my solid component. Okay, then I'm going to assign this to my block. Done. Now, then we are going to assemble these three over here. Okay, I cannot use a rigid. So what I'll do is I'll go to part. Since I cannot use a solid rigid, I'm going to convert the solid rigids into a hollow rigid. Then I'm going to assembly module. I'm going to assemble them over here. Now I have three components here. Okay, what I'll do is I'll assemble them. So with some conditions. This is a parallel face condition, which means the faces which I've selected should be parallel. Okay. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to position them. Okay, I'm going to rotate this around this axis. I'm going to rotate this component, this part, by 90 degrees. And again, I'll do the same. Again, for this, for better modeling. So as I've said, everything will be recorded over here. What you can do is you can do any modifications anytime. Okay. First, we'll position this over here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to use a translate option over here. This will translate this over here now. Okay, have you seen this, right? This has translated from one position to the other position. Now what I'll do is I'll, since I've deleted the support instance, I have since I have created only one support part, but I've instantiated it twice. So this is the beauty of Abacus. You don't have to model repeated components multiple times. Okay. Okay. Done. Then I'm going to use parallel faces for this. Again, also for this. Sorry. Okay. Now I'm going to rotate this around this axis by 90 degrees. And again, this on the same axis by 90. Then we're going to position them using the same options what we have used before. So select this point here. Okay, done. Next, we're going to position this. Okay, this is not rotated. Then we're going to position this point coincident with this point. Okay. Now we have positioned our 3-point bending setup. Now we have two supports and one load bearing component. So I have trimmed these lines, if you remember at the beginning for the block, just to take a reference of this to position the supports. Okay. Then what we're going to do is we are going to create a step for this. We're going to have a general static model, and I'm going to divide it by some load. I'm going to divide it by, so I'm asking the solver to apply 10% load, not all the load at a time, but 10% load as an increment. Okay, until the full load is absorbed. Next, I'm going to create contacts. Now, the conventional way of creating contacts is very lengthy process. Okay, maybe if you take any other in some solvers, in some C processors, preprocessors, what the process is like, you need to select the surface of one component, then select the surface of another component. You create a contact for it, then you repeat the same for this, for this, for this. Okay. Now for this component, it will take at least 5 or 10 minutes for me to create. But if you have a huge assembly, it might take a lot of time for you. Okay. So one advantage with Abacus is we have something called general contacts, where within one click you can create contacts for the entire assembly without repeating the process. So first way, I'm going to create some contact properties. So I'll provide some friction to this, say 0.2. My coefficient of friction is 0.2. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to create something called general contacts. Okay, looks like I have some problem with this. What I'll do is I'll save this for time being. Okay, let me end this. Just give me a minute. I think I have some problem with the window over here. I'm stop sharing this for a minute. I have restarted because I'm running some other simulation. I have some problem with this. What I'm going to do is I'm going to continue from where I've stopped. So we have assembled it. Now we have also created a step. Then what we're going to do is we also created a contact property, interaction property. Then we are going to create general contacts for this. So we are going to say general. So you can see here. What do you want to include in the contacts? You want to include all the components with self-contact. Self-contact is something where you where the same component comes in contact. Okay, like a crumbling analysis. Maybe we'll look at this in another demo, in the next demo. So you can imagine a crumbling or a crushing kind of thing, which is a self-contact. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell the solver I'm going to have everything in contact in the assembly, and I'm referencing the contact properties for this. Now the interactions are created. Next, I'm going to create the loads and boundary conditions. What I'm going to do is I'm going to fix this and this in all directions. So I'm not allowing this to these rigid components to move at all. Next, what we'll do is we'll provide a displacement load. Okay. I'm going to select this. I need a displacement in Z direction. What I'll do is I'll displace it by say 0.5 mm. Okay. And in all other directions, it is zero. Okay. Now we have done, created the assembly. Then we created the step. When we created the interaction where we have created the contacts, we have created the loads and boundary conditions. Next, we are going to mesh the components. So we'll provide the basic details on what is our average element size, say 10 mm for this. Okay. Then we're going to mesh this part. Okay, then we are going to move to the load block, which is a top block which we have created. Okay. Then we can go to the support block. Now, if you remember, we only created one support block, but we have two supports. But what we have done is during the assembly, we have used the same couple of times. Okay. At one end of the support, we have one support block, and other end, we have one more support block. Okay. That's the beauty of Abacus, where you can create one single part for multiple, and you can instantiate multiple times. You can use it multiple times when you have it repeated in your assembly. Okay, and it is not necessary you need to mesh it for all. Like if I'm using it 10 times in my model, it doesn't mean you need to mesh it 10 times. Only one time is enough. So if your meshing the parent part, it will be reflected on the other whatever the components which you have created. Okay, so we are going to provide some details on the mesh, and we have created the mesh for this as well. Okay, next, now we have assembled, we have created step interactions, more load, mesh is also done. You can see here, this is assembly, how it looks after the mesh. We are all done. Now we can go to job module and let's create a job. So once we submit on the job manager, okay, it will write out a INP file. Okay, this is a form of model file. I don't have any INP file over here, but so we have what we have done is we have created this bending. Okay, so this is the INP file, .INP file, which Abacus exports as a model file. So this file will be taken to the solver, and it has all the details, like what are the parts we have created. We have created a part name called block, and these are all the nodes for that part name. Okay, and each node will have its coordinates, XYZ coordinates. This is the X coordinate, this is the Y coordinate, and the Z coordinate, and this is the node number. Okay, similarly, we have okay, elements. What are the element types? What is the element type? And what are the, this is a solid element, 3D, C3D 8R, which is a 3D element, 8-noded 3D hexa element. Okay. Now each element will have its element number and its coordinate, node ID. And it will have other details like, the general contacts what we have created, okay, and other assembly details over here. It has created assembly details here, assembly, what are the assemblies we have created. We have a block, we have another load block which holds a load, and we have two supports which is instantiated over here. It is here, and we have created some material properties which is over here, the boundary conditions. We have display cement and fixed constraints over here. It is also written, and interaction properties, which is a contacts. Now everything is written. At the end, it will also write out the step information. Okay, I think I had some too much load on it. Okay, this is how it will write out. Okay. So this file will be submitted to the solver, and the solver will understand what is what from this file, and it will try to calculate based on the provided inputs. What I'm going to do is, okay, so this is the result after the analysis. Now you can take the result file. So once the analysis is completed, the solver will write out the results in the form of .odb file. Okay, this will have all the calculated results, like your stress, your displacement, and everything. You can use this for further post-processing. this is how you model you know, some complex problems in Abacus. See, for some reason the analysis which I've carried didn't go well, but so let us not waste time on it. Maybe something to do with my contacts or something. Yeah, but this is the result will look like once you have everything in place. Okay. Now, since this is the only deformable component in the assembly, we can only see results for this. Anyway, these are the rigid components, and we are not interested in the rigid components. So, since we are only interested in the block, which is a rigid, which is a deformable, and we have only created a single deformable component for a better speed simulation. When you have more number of deformable components, the simulation time will increase. Okay, so this is about using implicit. This is a more of an implicit solver, implicit simulation. Okay. Next, we'll see an explicit simulation as well. Okay, we'll try to create something on explicit as well. So in this explicit, again, we can, let's see a crush analysis where we're going to use self-contacts, tube crush. So we are going to use a, say for example, a hollow tube of so what we are going to do is we are going to create a hollow tube of say 100 by 100 mm. Something like this. Let's extrude by like 100. Okay, 100 may not be enough. This is my cube. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to crush this cube with a solid block. So for that, I'm going to create a solid block. So we have created 100 by 100 for that. So we're going to create 120 by 120 for this so that we can have a better. We're going to create a square block, something like this. Now we have created a square block, and we're going to attach a rigid reference point for this since it's a rigid component. Then we're going to properties. Let's assign some details to this. Let's assign some material. Now we'll use aluminium material, for example. Form of aluminium. Okay. With some Young's modulus and Poisson's ratio. We'll also provide some details on plasticity. Like we're going to include the material nonlinearity in this. Okay. Now we have created the material. Now we're going to tell the solver what type of component it is. A shell component with some, which has some thickness. Let's say thickness of 2 mm. Okay. And we are assigning a material to this. Then we are going to attach element and property to this. Okay. Next we have the block. Since it is a rigid component, but we are using a dynamic explicit simulation. So when you're using a dynamic simulation, you need Mars. Okay, since it's a dynamic simulation where you know you have your inertia and everything, we need Mars for this. We're going to create some properties to this. We're going to say like what is the mass, maybe 1 ton. Okay, 1 ton, and some random shape properties for this. Then we're going to assembly module, we'll assemble these two. Okay, I've created a solid. What I'm going to do is I'm going to convert this into shell component assembly. Okay. So this is how you have it. And we're going to translate this. Okay, again, we're going to translate this so that this is how we are going to position the y direction. I need to position this in negative y direction by say like 15, something like this, but maybe more than that. And now we have positioned it. This may not be the right position, but we can actually work with it for time being. To have a little gap between these two components. Okay, now we have assembled it. Now we I have a tube and I have a block, and this block is going to crush the tube. So in order to get it crushed, I need to create some constraint for this and also contacts. What we are going to do is we are going to tell the solver and that I'm going to use explicit analysis for a period of say 0.1. So my event time is 0.1. Okay, next, interactions. I'll create interaction properties first. Some friction of say 0.1. General contacts for explicit. Including the self contact. So once the tube gets crushed, the same component or the elements in the same tube will come in contact with each other. So this will this is called self contact, and general contacts will help in creating that. Next is the loads and boundary conditions. What we are going to do is we will constrain, or we are going to fix the edges on the other side of the tube in all directions. Okay, and we are going to provide velocity to this rigid body in z direction, say like 500 mm per second of velocity. Okay, now we have done, we have created the assembly, we have provided the physical properties and material properties for the tube, and also we are going to tell the solver that this is, this block is a rigid component and it has a mass of say 1 ton. Now we have created the loads, boundary conditions. Next we are going to mesh the component. Done. Next we'll go to tube. It may be very less. We'll make it 3.5. Okay. Now we have our assembly ready. We are going to submit the solver. You can see the solver has taken the input file and it started. It will check if there are any modeling errors. If there aren't any modeling errors, then it will start analyzing the start calculations. If there are any errors regarding the calculations, it will stop the analysis and it will give you the details of it. You can see how you can, so these are the intermediate results. The analysis is not yet completed, but you can see the results over here, how this tube is getting crushed because of the block. So that you can see here, so far it has done the analysis for 0.09 seconds. Once it is observed the complete load, the analysis will come out and we can see the results. See how it is getting crushed. This is how it gets crushed over here. You can see it here. You can see here the elements are getting in contact with each other, and because of that, they're using self contact for this. This is all about how you model for express simulation. It hardly took like 10 minutes for me to create this. It's pretty easy. It's everything is logically organized. Okay, so it doesn't mean you have to go according to this. It's up to you. You can mesh the component first and you can apply the load later. Anything is possible. Okay, so it doesn't, when we say it is logically organized, it doesn't mean you need to follow the same you know, chronology. It's up to you how you want to model your components. Okay. What we'll see a small problem on optimization also by importing the existing plate model what we have created earlier. There is a plate model, if you remember, which we have created at the beginning. Okay, it has some property and we have assembled it. We have provided the load for it and also some boundary conditions. Okay. I'll probably change the load for this. What I'll do is I'll select all the nodes. Done. Okay. I have the loads over here. what I'll do is I'll do a topology optimization on this plate. So I'm going to tell the solver, okay, I'm doing an optimization, which is a topology optimization. And this is my region of interest. Okay, so I need to, I'm telling the optimization solver, this is the area where you need to perform the optimization. Okay. I'm not going into details what is sensitive based optimization, what is condition based optimization, but for the time being, I'll show you how to do it. Next is the responses. So, for like you have loads and boundary conditions for a general analysis, for optimization, you need some conditions. So, what are the conditions? So, conditions are nothing but your constraints, optimization constraints, and optimization objective. What is the objective? Whether you want to reduce the stiffness, or you want to increase the stiffness, or increase the mass, or reduce the mass, or increase the stress, or reduce the stress. These are all your conditions. Okay, these conditions can be your objective or can be your constraints. So I'm going to create such conditions over here. What I'm going to do, I'm going to ask the solver to give me a best shape with a first of all, what I'll do is I'll create two conditions. One is volume and one is strain energy. Strain energy is nothing but your stiffness. Okay. I'll tell you how it is used. So minimizing strain energy is nothing but you're asking the solver to give you a structure within the same domain, within the same design space for a given set of loads and boundary conditions, to have a better structure with better stiffness or same stiffness with reduced volume in this case. I'm asking the solver to provide a design with minimized strain energy or minimized stiffness. You can see here it is a strain energy. This is objective. Now I've created an objective. Okay, my objective is a structure with a better stiffness. Next, I'm going to create a constraint. So you need some constraint to you know, to tell the solver. Here my constraint is volume. Okay, I'm telling the solver to, you know, provide some design with at least removing 50% of the volume, okay, to a maximum of 15% and retain 50% of the material. This is my material density. Okay, now what happens is I've created everything here. Okay, I've created a, I'm telling the solver to run a topology optimization. I have two conditions. One is stiffness and volume. Okay, my objective is to maximize the stiffness or minimize the strain energy in this case. And the constraint is to reduce the volume of the provided structure. Then what I'll do is, then I'm going to submit the job or the input file to the optimization solver. Okay. So in order to run an optimization, you need a design space. It's nothing but your the area where you want to perform the optimization. Okay, a design responses. Design responses are nothing but what I've shown you are the conditions. Okay, like objective conditions and or your boundary constraint conditions. These are nothing but your these takes your responses. Okay, okay. Here in this case, I've used a strain energy as my responses. Strain energy and volume as my response. Strain energy is my objective, and volume is my constraint. I have asked the solver to give me a better design with a reduced volume and better stiffness. It started, the solver has running. It will keep on iterating until my objectives and constraints are met. You can also plot how the trend is going, like how my objective and constraints are following with respect to each iteration, my stiffness. And you can see here stiffness objective, which is in red. It is trying to increase the stiffness, and the constraint, it is trying to reduce the volume here. So you can see my constraint is to have at least 50% of volume. It is trying to reduce the volume here, at the same time minimizing the strain energy for a particular iteration over here. So this is taking some time, but let's wait for the solver to come out with the result. Please stop sharing screen for a minute. We're almost coming close. Okay, simulation is completed. So what we'll do is we'll post-process the results. Done. So it's okay. This is my final. Oh, sorry. So this is my final shape after optimization. Okay. So let's see how it progressed. You see here, this was my initial shape. Then the solver slowly started removing the material. You can see this is what is unnecessary. What you can see is the red one is retained elements, and the blue ones are the removing, which are not really important, not really contributing to the stiffness. So this is how the solver will try to provide us a better result. So you can see here, the solver has given an optimized shape. So this has reduced the weight of it. At the same time, it has retained the stiffness of the component without actually changing much of the disturbing the stiffness. So this is how you do optimization, not just topology optimization. You can also do a bead optimization or topography optimization, where you move the nodes of the elements, okay, of a 2D structure. Okay, if you look at your government buses, the floor, you have some beads on it, right? So it is basically because to improve the stiffness of the structure. So you can use for such applications where you want to improve the stiffness or increase the frequency, for example. And you can also do size optimization, where you can change the thickness, okay, where the solver play with the thickness of the sheet metal components. Or you can do shape optimization, where the shape of the 3D structure will be changed. Okay, this is how you do optimization with Tosca in Abacus environment. Tosca also, it has its own graphic user interface, but I'm not going into that for time being. But you can do optimization through Abacus CAE itself using the optimization module. Okay, let me go back to my presentation. I'll stop presenting for a minute. I hope you can see my screen.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so we have done some problems and also one optimization problem in this. Next, I'm going to talk about something called 3D Experience Platform. So 3D Experience Platform gives you access to a catalog of applications. Okay, like, oh, you can see here, right? This is what we call as a compass, and each compass has different quadrants, north, south, east, and west quadrant. And you can see under the same umbrella, you can actually use CATIA, SOLIDWORKS, etc., all your modeling applications, all your simulation applications, all your collaborative application, and everything is collaborated and connected. Okay, these apps allows you to design, simulate, inform, and collaborate on a project. For example, let's say way back in 1990s or maybe in the early 2000s, this is how you do the project. Now, when you have a project, you have a group of people. Okay, a project cannot be done by one person; it's a group of people. Where you have a engineer. Okay, let's imagine you're building something. Okay. And in this project, you have an engineer, a design engineer, a marketing engineer, or sorry, a marketing guy, a programmer, and a simulation guy, etc. In olden days, you have to brainstorm, you have to manage the data, a lot of things, a lot of headaches. You need to communicate to and from email chains, etc., etc. emails and communicating. A lot of mess, you know. Now, after that, we have some simulation, high performance computing, et cetera, but still you need to exchange the emails. And if somebody leaves the project, your data is gone because he will have all the files with him or with her. Then all your data is gone. Again, you need to begin from where it is stopped. It's a lot of headache and it's a lot of time-consuming process. A 3D experience platform is more of a data-centric rather than a file-centric. And it's you can actually use any platform to start using this. Okay, so it's more data-centric rather than file-based, which eliminates a lot of communication with emails or messages, etc. And updates are automatically reflected, so it's easy. You can easily collaborate, and you can easily communicate within the same platform. You don't have to go back to, you know, another email application, draft emails, send it to your manager or your project leader. It's a lot of big mess. Okay, and yeah, these are some of the capabilities of 3D experience platform. Okay, you model, you simulate. It's like an entire 3D PLM. You market, you do everything in this. Okay, so you collaborate internally, social, internal and external communications, your ideations, your surveys, everything can be done within this. It's all data driven. Okay, it's not like you save a bunch of files in somewhere and you retrieve it back and forth. And if somebody changes, he need to inform you. Like, if I have some problem with my simulation, I have to go back to the designer and I have to tell him, and he'll do the modifications. And again, I have to get the design, redo the same process of meshing, loading, etc., which is a very long process. So what happens here is, when there is some change made by the designer, it will be automatically reflected in my simulation. It will carry the simulation in the background. Okay. So managing personal access to technology, etc., it's all simulation democratized in a democratized manner. Okay. So it's all about 3D experience. It gives and also maybe the first in the entire CAE, across any CAE world, Abacus or the Similia has providing cloud capabilities for academics. So when we say cloud capabilities, now the situation is very grim. Like, everybody is working from home or the colleges are shut. Now you don't have access to most of your computer hardware which you're using in your university. So how cloud will help you is, you can work from wherever you are. You don't need a huge setup. You need a big high-end machine. All you need is a simple laptop or maybe, you know, any platform, iOS platform, for example. You can also use your iPad to simulate something sitting at your home, at your own comfort. Everything will be stored in the cloud, and it's very secured. All your data will be secured. And this is, if you look at any other CE vendor, I think it's only Similia is offering cloud for academics, which will make easy for your for all your professors and students to do the designing or simulation or any ideation sitting at their own comfort without actually going to their college or universities using high-end machines. Okay, so this is all I have for today. And I think we can take some question and answers. And I hope you have gained some knowledge today. So there's a question from Mihir Patil. In case explicit dynamic impact analysis, what are the checks we do to confirm if your simulation is correct or not? Yes, there are a couple of checks. One is energy checks. You can compare your internal energy, kinetic energy, and total energy. So the total energy should be unchanged. Okay, maybe 1 or 2% it will change, but it should not be a drastic change.
So Prakash sir?
Yes sir.
We have Professor Bhupesh Goel with us.
Okay.
Professor Bhupesh.
Hello sir.
Hello Bhupesh.
Hello Prakash ji. This is Bhupesh Goel, Assistant Professor, Mechanical Department, Parul University.
Okay.
So thanks for the sessions which have provided the knowledge about Abacus. Now my basic question regarding this is, Generally, all the analysis software provides some results with the errors. Let's say the considerable errors we generally say, right? So what are the percentage of error generally Abacus is providing to us? Like in Ansys, what I'm right now using Ansys. So Ansys is providing the result with 6 to 7% error. So that is acceptable.
Okay.
So what generally the error range Abacus is providing?
See, there is nothing called range of errors. Okay. It completely depends on how you're modeling, what are your assumptions are. How you're modeling, okay, compared to your, you know, your actual product or actual assembly, for example.
Okay.
There is no that you can draw the errors. So if your test is giving 100 newtons or 100 newton per mmpa of stress, and if you're getting 98% in simulation, which is valid.
Something which is called validation. Generally, we use the word validation. So if I'm performing the same experiment, the way I perform the analysis, the same thing I will perform with the experiment.
Yes.
So what will be the considerable range, I would say, let's, I'll not say error, let's say. Then what should I say? I'll consider my results of experiment same as the analysis.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the error of the error can be anywhere between 5 to 7%. Anything more than that is not acceptable, because the more the errors, then you're moving away from the reality.
Okay, fine.
Okay, thank you, Prakash sir. We have one guest there, Pokri Lucky. She want to ask how to apply the mass for the extract part in the slab.
Sorry, I didn't understand.
Actually, we have one guest with us.
How to apply Ms. mesh? Okay, I can read it. I can read it. I can.
Yes.
Read it.
Yes.
How to
yes.
apply mesh for extract part in a slab? Here, I'm extracting half of the depth, not full depth. I'm not really clear about the question. Maybe we can connect later. Maybe with a small image or something, you can share some details. I can give you my email ID. And you can
ma'am, if you want to ask right now, ma'am, okay, ma'am, you can please.
Yeah, it's up to you, professor. If you have time, I'll ask now, otherwise later also it's okay.
Yeah, if you have something you can share, or we can connect later. I have anyway given my email ID in the chat box. You can drop an email when we can discuss.
Okay, professor, thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.
So we have another question here from Mr. Bhavya Shah. He want to ask, can Abacus visualize rolling and rotating conditions?
Yes.
Okay. We have Professor Prince Rathore with us. Professor Prince?
Yes, I'm here.
Hi, Prince.
Hello. Good morning, sir. Actually, I am from Civil Engineering Department. Okay. And I would like to know that this software I can use for the stress distribution in our foundation where we are applying the structure in the below
absolutely.
The ground, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So as okay. I am using the Plexus and all, so mm-hmm. can I use this software similarly for this simulation for the stress distribution in the below the footings?
Yes. So you must be using concrete material, right, for that?
Yeah, I want to make first one concrete, right? And the stress distribution according to the load condition, I can apply this kind of structure, right? This kind
yes,
of
yes, 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 yeah, correct. Yeah, you can actually use it.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Also, we have one more query from Priyank Kumar Patel. You yeah. want to ask the difference in the steps between the part, property, assembly steps? Yes.
Okay, so part is where you create your part, okay, your geometry, your basic geometry, okay. Property is where you tell the solver what exactly the part is, okay. So I've created a plate, okay. I know that is a plate, but I need to tell the solver, okay, whether that is a plate or some other solid component and what is the thickness of the plate. So through the property, I assign the property and material in the property module, okay, and I'll communicate to the solver saying that, okay, this is my plate with a thickness of 2 mm and which has a material of steel, That is a property module. And assembly module is where you assemble. Like if you remember the three point bending analysis, which we have seen earlier, I have four different components or three different parts. One is a block, one is a top roller, and one other two supports. Now I have created the parts in Abacus. Now I need to assemble it. So in the assembly module, I'll assemble all this. I'll assemble them in a very logical sense. So that is the assembly module about. I hope you understood, Priyank.
Okay. We have one more faculty with us, Professor Rajiv Baghel.
Okay.
Professor Rajiv.
Hello. Good morning, sir. Myself is Rajiv Baghel from Aeronautical Department. Sir, in aeronautical department, generally for dynamic analysis, mm-hmm. particularly when we talk about crash analysis or explicit dynamics, mm-hmm. I think this software is really very helpful. So, okay. Can you tell the students how this Abacus or LS-DYNA is important when we talk about the SPH model or you can say the crash analysis? Or can you conduct one more lecture, particularly for this crash analysis?
I'll probably check about this, but explicit, like for example, you can do some bird strike analysis in Abacus with SPH elements or CEL elements.
Okay.
Or any crack simulations also.
Yeah.
With Abacus, there are a lot of applications. Probably you can connect with Jyoti Electronics. Okay, they have provided their email ID. We can discuss through them.
Jyoti
Electronics. They have provided the details in the chat. Mr. Parth Agarwal has provided the details. We can discuss some cases on aeronautics, aerospace and aeronautic department. Okay.
So, sir, can you conduct
Yes. We'll try to do something. Let me check with Jyoti Electronics about it, and we'll discuss and we can arrange something. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
Rajiv, sir. Any more query from the participants? If you want to be asked, make your mic unmute, and one by one, you can able to ask to the or respected guest. Anyone?
Very good morning, sir. It's Harish Devjani from Mechanical Engineering Department, Assistant Professor.
Hi, Harish.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for such a wonderful demonstration. My questions are a bit apart from this particular software, rather than they are towards the common CAE. Right. First one is about how can we simulate the behavior of any a thread or a cloth or a wire mesh kind of thing.
Okay. Something like airbag.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, airbag can be simulated. Airbag simulations can be done in Abacus, explicit analysis.
Okay, so for that, the type of element that we are going to select would be?
What I've shown so far is something very basic, okay?
Yes.
Now, when we go into airbags, there are a lot of things you need to consider, like the air inside the bag and what is the element type for it and what is the air type, etc., etc. It's a very long discussion again.
Okay, fine.
Okay, it has its own element type. Okay. Probably what we can do is we can connect offline and we can discuss.
Okay, sure, sir. I got your mail ID. I'll surely connect with you.
Yeah.
So there is one more question that I want to ask. Sorry for the extending the time, but you know, that is a problem I faced last year when I was trying to simulate a bearing in a modern analysis.
Okay.
Right. So basically, we cannot put the bearing as a rigid material. Right. We have to provide it flexibility, especially when it comes to towards the modal analysis of anything, when we are trying to find the natural frequency.
Okay. Okay.
So how do we simulate such kind of thing, right? For bearing which has some of the flexibility, right, or which has some of the movement inherent in movement.
Now, I'm not completely clear about your question. Maybe can you drop me a mail with your question? We can discuss.
Sure. I'll,
there is a rigid part and a deformable part in your question, which is confusing. Okay,
I'll share drop a screenshot also and with the detail of the problem.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Harris. Thank you for your wild questions. So we have another query from the Mr. Rahul Singh. He's an M-Tech automobile. He want to ask how we can get job in this particular job field like simulation or design sector.
That's a very interesting question and very tough question. Okay, one second. Let me share a slide which I might have missed yesterday. I hope you can see my screen.
Yes.
Okay. So yesterday, I talked about industry bandwidth of usage of the software, and NAFEMS has conducted a survey. Okay, this is also available online. You can check this. And if you look at the survey, around 55% of the users use Abacus. Okay, now this will tell you the quality of the software what we are talking about here.
Hello.
Yeah, Mr. Parth.
Shukla sir, Rajas is trying to speak something. Hello? Can you unmute him? I think he's not able to unmute himself.
Sir, हमारे end से तो नहीं है ऐसा, हमने unmute
किया. उन्हीं को करना होगा.
उनको बोले rejoin करें. हाँ, उनको rejoin.
अच्छा.
Any other participant, if you have any sort of queries, please ask to our guest, anyone. If you have. Okay, so Prakash sir, I think the people, yes, okay, people don't have much query right now, and I think the today's session is going to clear everything, and I would like to say all the participants that we already shared the feedback link in the chat box, even though we also going to be mail you the same within a next 10 to 15 minutes. You have to make it filled before 1 p.m. today itself, and then after you are going to be eligible for the certificates. On the behalf of Parul University and the entire family, on the behalf of Head of Department, Professor Imran Malvi, I am Om Prakash Shukla, Professor in the Mechanical Department.
Sir, feel my privilege. Can we wait for a minute? Maybe Rajas want to speak to the audience.
Yeah, please. Sir,
Rajas, please. Is our sales manager. We would like to...
I think Rajat sir is still having some difficulties to make himself unmute.
Okay,
sir. So again, okay. I would like to say my sincere thanks to you on the behalf of Parul University. Special thanks to the Parth sir, Prakash sir, and your team for making this last 2 days successfully. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for all the audience who have attended this. And being patient since last for the entire 2 days. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.